Oh, hi, I didn't see you there. My name is Bliss Foster. Welcome to episode 8 of my ongoing series exploring every single runway show by Maison Martin Margiela that Martin Margiela was involved with. Today we are careening into fall winter 1992, and I am so excited because there's a lot of good foundational stuff in this show. It's going to be really excellent. The hilarious joke that many journalists had been making about Martin's work was kind of the equivalent of making the Zoolander derelict joke, just sort of that it's like, oh, this is all like homeless people's stuff, how quaint. In the Journal du Textile, they said it looked like his collections came from cardboard boxes at the Salvation Army, and Margiela thought, that's not a bad idea, let's have a show at the Salvation Army. Typically, when an art-based company comes into another regular business and they try to set stuff up for a special art thing, it is really annoying for the business. This is true of movie studios and fashion companies and studio art presentations. Usually businesses agree to like work with these people and then they end up kind of regretting it in the end. Not true here. The Salvation Army employees loved having them there. They thought this was the coolest thing ever. In the women's collections book, they point out this specific fact that I thought had been in place before. But what it says is, for the first time, a large piece of white cardboard in the shape of a letter was sent to guests, stamped with the date and the place of the presentation. To the guests' great surprise, the letter received did not reveal an assigned row. Indeed, the shows would have no seating chart, and each person found their place as instructed by employees dressed in white lab coats. Okay, so the employees as ushers thing, like I knew that that was new, but I thought that the seating chart had never existed. I thought this was just kind of like a Southwest flight where it's like, just pick whatever seat, man. But the women's collections book was part of the 20th anniversary gallery and it was overseen by Martin, so I'm gonna assume that they are correct. And if we do assume that they are correct, this is a gargantuan smack in the face to fashion journalists at the time. This is not a standard protocol thing at all. The whole thing is based on this very elaborate, like Versailles kind of, like, oh, you get to sit here, you get to sit here, but you don't get to sit there anymore, you get to sit back here now. It's still like that for really big, important houses to a certain degree, but back then it was just very OD. Everybody was very fixated on this idea of rank and like where you get to sit. So as per usual, they're kind of democratizing the process and spreading everybody out, just sort of like you, when you get there, like someone will point at you and then point at a seat. And when I say seat, I mean that term very loosely because they were actually sitting on like washing machines and like weird furniture and mattresses, just kind of whatever was around. Perhaps the most atmospherically impactful part of this entire show is that they had a complete brass band marching along the runway along with the models. The styling for this show is a lot like the collection in this show. We're keeping things, for the most part, fairly minimal. A lot of the models had shoelaces tied around their necks in this cute little bow. And let me check here, other styling details. There are none. That's it for the styling. So stay with me as we explore the clothes themselves right after this. Wait. I was checking to see if the camera was on. I have a Patreon and I really would appreciate it if you would support it. I want to make more of these episodes. I want to make them faster, but I can only do that if you help me by joining my Patreon. I promise. You won't be doing me any favors if you do so, because you'll be able to join the private Discord server where there are dozens of other people who know so much more about fashion than I do. Everyone is always talking and joking about clothes. It's wonderful. The link is down in the description, but I don't really think you need it because it's just patreon.com/blissfoster. I hope you can support me on Patreon, and I look forward to it. You're all great.
Perhaps the most memorable part of this entire show is that we have these little girls that are walking the runway along with these fully grown adult women. Because of the washing technique used on some of these vintage clothes, they shrunk unexpectedly. So the Maison reached out to certain models that they knew were going to be walking in the show and asked them to bring along their daughters. And these girls walked the show with their moms. The Maison made the decision to do this, and it's part of a pattern that they've had going since their very inception. Leave something half done here, keep a mistake there. And I want to stop on this for a little bit because there's such a difficulty with curation. It is an art form that can trick the viewer into thinking that it is easy. Stuff like this almost seems to be begging one to say, and maybe some of you are now thinking, this sucks! This is lazy! There is no art here! This is just people thrifting stuff, modifying it slightly, and then selling it for the same high price as actual luxury items that take time and skill to make.
But here's the thing. During the process of creating this collection, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of opportunities for the Maison to incorporate some kind of mistake or half-done project into the final show. What's
artful here is not so much that they included a mistake, it's that they included a mistake that continues this ongoing story that they've already established about incorporating the family into their runway shows. We had the boyfriend of one model lifting the little boy up onto her shoulders so that she could walk him down the runway. We had the two lovers walking down the runway, kinda drunk at one point. We had a model walking with her little kid and her boyfriend who had to wear a white lab coat in order to stay with her and do this. The idea of bringing family members onto the Maison Martin Margiela runway is not something that is new. This is something that they've already set up as part of the DNA of their brand. And to be able to recycle the reality of an error into an already established storyline with your brand is a really beautiful thing. Additionally, incorporating these little girls into the show made it where they're right next to their moms, and they're emphasizing the fact that they're beautiful model mom is not a 20-year-old. And with that, they can kind of underscore a ongoing theme that they've had for forever as well, which is that these clothes are not for women of a certain age or physique, they're for women of a certain mindset. I mean, the art of curation is hard enough, but they're perfectly selecting the right mistakes to incorporate that will build out the world of Maison Martin Margiela season over season. I mean, this is no easy task, friends.
Well, I still don't like it because I'm close-minded.
Well, I have no way to help you with that. One thing that we do have documented about this show, but that isn't very obvious from just looking at the runway photos or even some of the video, is that a lot of the clothes for this show are being worn backwards. And that's something that we've seen from the very first show with the backwards skirt. And then we also saw the backwards shirt in the following show. The most obvious example in this show is these backwards leather coats that they're wearing. As always, they've actually modified the pattern itself so that you're not just clumsily wearing a jacket backwards, you're actually able to put it on and it feels surprisingly natural to wear it that way. One model is seen here wearing one of their asymmetrical skirts, an under top made from these split leggings. There's a really interesting thing that they do here where they've taken a pair of leggings and they've split them at the crotch and then they wear them as a top. I don't know if you did point or ballet dance, especially as a kid, or if you were close to someone who did, but that whole culture is this very strange combination of a focus on grace and beauty and delicacy, but also just very hardcore, brutal, backbreaking work. I mean, if you've ever seen dancers try to modify or break in their shoes, they're rougher on that shit than people are with motorcycles. It all has this very DIY sort of punk side to it. Not to say that the whole thing is like super punk or whatever, but there's a side of that that kind of has that same sort of like hunched over and like doing it yourself sort of mentality. And that seems to sort of be the side of all of this that they're trying to capture here by just like splitting the crotch open, putting your head over it, putting it on as a top and being like, okay, what are we doing? But back to the look, this model is wearing one of those asymmetrical skirts, like I said, and then this undertop made from these split leggings, and then separate sleeves from a separate knitwear piece, leather gloves, and a satin lining tucked in as a top. We're seeing them still executing this very complex layering, but without making things overly bulky. That's something that we've seen the entire time. We've talked about it a million times. This is a really good execution of that technique. Because again, and especially here in 2020, when we're doing lots of layering, it makes a bulky silhouette, and we want it to now. That's kind of the look that we're all trying to go for. But back then, this very like trim silhouette was something that was very in at the time for high fashion, and they were finding a way to layer a whole bunch, but still keep that very slight trim silhouette. So by contrast, we also see these knitwear pieces that are incredibly bulky. In the documentary, Margiela, in his own words, he talks a lot about his love from a very young age of dressing dolls, and that he really likes the way that the clothes fit on the dolls in that scale. And of course, we're going to see this idea get executed in a very full-fledged way in the doll collection that will be in a couple of seasons. But for now, we're kind of seeing an earlier stage of this idea. Because the way that they've cut these knitwear pieces, they bunch up and they have that bulkiness, that sort of artificial bulkiness that comes with making clothes that are this big. And this other one here is fantastic because we can see that they added in darts at the knees to give it that very full a doll's outfit affect in the skirt area. This specific one might be a single knitwear piece. It seems to have separate legs, so it's more of a knit jumpsuit, though this could just be the way that the skirt was falling at the moment the photo was taken. That actually might just be a knit dress. All rise. One piece in particular stood out to everyone who was present there and still stands the test of time today in museums, and that is a clear plastic dress bag that they got from Denny Claire, that manufacturer that was being so difficult with them last season. Anyway, they took this clear plastic dress bag. It's the same kind of bag you would get at the dry cleaners when you have your stuff returned to you. And what it looks like is they put it onto a very large dress form. This is a vintage dress form that they got. It was produced in 1936. It was a size 44, or in Italian sizing, that would be a 78. It's huge. At least for dress forms that are at a luxury house, that is much larger than most that would be available. And it looks like they did is they took that dress bag and they put it around this large dress form, and then they taped around it and then pulled it off. You may be seated. So the dress bag is already huge. It's way, way bigger than it should be because it's meant to put whatever size dress into it. Then they're taking the large dress form and putting the even larger bag over top that, and then taping it down so that the dress bag is now the same size as the dress form. And then they are taking that and putting it onto a tiny model. Dress bag, dress form, model. And again, here we see them incorporating the idea of the dress form into the runway show itself. We're getting some different flavors for the way that this is being used, but I don't know if we can yet reach any real conclusions about this, but it's coming. I know where we're going with this, and it is coming, I promise. Going back to the tights, those actually were also worn as a belt in this show over a large cardigan with some distorted pockets. There's also these sleeves that we still have some great samples of in museums now that were made from old leather coats. These were used all over this runway show, and they were also sold in the stores as their own accessory. Beautiful little idea. Hey, Lindsay got home just now.
Hi.
Hi, Lindsay. Hello. Hello, Lindsay. Under one of the longer black coats is a black, what they call a cut-up dress top, and a pair of denim jeans that have been painted black. The coat is a replica of a cassock. And they did an excellent job with those details too, because there are actually 33 buttons the way that they're supposed to be, one for each year of Jesus' life. So for the Maison, these coats that have been converted into dresses, this seems like a fairly simple move, but I mean, just look at these things. They're gorgeous. This is really a show where they're coming into their own as far as the aesthetic of the house is concerned. Remember that most other houses in Paris are showing very skimpy, very revealing, very playful clothing. Again, as I've said before, nothing wrong with that. Usually, even during the fall-winter season, we have these like very like revealing, kind of like girly outfits, but they're staying very true to their vision at the Maison, and they're showing the sexiness that's brought from character. Very steamy stuff. But even beyond those specific pieces, they're really nailing down what they want to be good, sellable product for the Maison, and probably making a bid with buyers to start getting bigger orders. Because for the most part, the number of conceptual things in this show, they're fairly limited. But what I'm seeing here is a lot of really solid product that's being presented in a really beautiful way, very bohemian way, with a very complete story that's being told through the location and the band and the models with their daughters, and everything is being presented in this wonderful way, but they're really bringing some solid product this season. It'd be interesting to know if that worked, but that's just information we don't really have access to. Mwah! Thank you so much for joining me this week. Please do not forget to follow me on YouTube, Instagram, and Twitter. Do not forget to support my Patreon. It's patreon.com/blissfoster. You also have a link down in the description if you are bad at remembering what I just said. I love you with the white hot intensity of 1,000 suns. Goodbye.